Cuando yo voy a confesarme, es para sanarme, para curar mi alma, para salir con más salud espiritual, para pasar de la miseria a la misericordia. El centro de la confesión no son los pecados que decimos, sino el amor divino que recibimos y que siempre necesitamos. El centro de la confesión es Jesús, que nos espera, nos escucha y nos perdona. Recuerden esto, en el corazón de Dios estamos nosotros antes que nuestras equivocaciones. Y recemos para que vivamos el sacramento de la reconciliación con renovada profundidad y para saborear el perdón y la infinita misericordia de Dios. Y recemos para que Dios dé a su iglesia sacerdotes misericordiosos y no torturadores.
Oh. Good morning. Welcome to the celebration of the Eucharist. My name is Angelica Garcia, and I will be the commentator for today's liturgy. Today, we are celebrating the third Sunday of Lent, and this Mass is offered for Segundo S. Posadas, Sergio A. Flores, Lynn Marie Posadas, Lisa Eden, Maximina Dunca, Anita Duarte, and Marina Pengen. Presiding our celebration today is Father Dario Miranda. In order to have a dignifying and holy celebration, I ask you to please make sure that your cell phones are turned off and that we have left gum, drinks, and food outside this sacred place. Also, please take a moment to prepare your offering for today. Please remember that the ushers are not authorized to give out change or break bills during the offertory collection. Now, let us have a moment of prayerful silence to prepare ourselves to enter into the presence of our Heavenly Father, who welcomes us to this celebration. Now, let's all stand and join in singing the entrance hymn.
Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to church this morning. Today we begin this journey with the catechumens, with the scrutinies, and all of us as members of the church, we walk with them, united not only in prayer, but also in the same spirit of repentance, in the same spirit of conversion. Today you are going to join me on celebrating the first scrutiny of the elect, those who were chosen last week to be called to the sacraments of Easter, to the Easter sacraments of baptism, communion, and confirmation. So we welcome them and we join them in prayer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of the Father, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. Let us prepare to celebrate this Eucharist acknowledging our sins. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have gravely sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done, in what I have failed to do. To my fault, to my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask, Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Let us pray. Grant, we pray, O Lord, that these chosen ones may come worthily and wisely to the confession of your praise, so that in accordance with that first dignity which they lost by original sin, they may be fashioned anew through your glory, through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Let us please be seated.
A reading from the book of Exodus. In those days, in their thirst for water, the people grumbled against Moses, saying, "Why did you ever make us leave Egypt? Was it just to have us die here of thirst with our children and our livestock?" So Moses cried out to the Lord, "What shall I do with this people? A little more, and they will stone me." The Lord answered Moses, "Go over there in front of the people, along with some of the elders of Israel, holding in your hand as you go the staff with which you struck the river. I will be standing there in front of you, the rock in Horeb. Strike the rock, and the water will flow from it for the people to drink." This Moses did in the presence of the elders of Israel. The place was called Massah and Meribah because the Israelites quarreled there and tested the Lord, saying, "Is the Lord in our midst or not?" The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus came to a town of Samaria called Sychar, near the plot of land that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there. Jesus, tired from his journey, sat down there at the well. It was about noon. A woman of Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." His disciples had gone into the town to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How can you, a Jew, ask me, a Samaritan woman, for a drink? For Jews use nothing in common with Samaritans." Jesus answered to her, "If you knew the gift of God, and who is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would ask him, and he would give you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you do not even have a bucket, and the cistern is deep. Where then can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us this cistern and drank from it himself with his children and his flock?" Jesus answered and said to her, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks the water I shall give will never thirst. The water I shall give you will become a spring of water welling up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I may not be thirsty or have to keep coming here to draw water." Jesus said to her, "Go call your husband and come back." The woman answered, "I do not have a husband." Jesus said, "You're right in saying I do not have a husband, for you have had five husbands, and the one you have now is not your husband. What you have said is true." The woman said to him, "Sir, I can see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshipped in this mountain, but you people say that the place to worship is in Jerusalem." Jesus said to her, "Believe me, woman, the hour is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You people worship what you do not know or understand. We worship what we understand, because salvation comes from the Jews. But the hour is coming, and is now here, when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. And indeed, the Father seeks such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth." The woman said to him, "I know that the Messiah is coming, the one called the Christ. When he comes, he will tell us everything." Jesus said to her, "I am he, the one speaking with you." At that moment, his disciples returned and were amazed that he was talking with a woman, but still no one said, "What are you looking for?" or "Why are you talking with her?" The woman left her water jar and went into the town and said to the people, "Come, see a man who told me everything I have done. Could he possibly be the Christ?" The town and came to him. Meanwhile, the disciples he said to them, I have food to eat of which you do not know. So the disciples said to one another, could someone have brought him something to eat? Jesus said to them, my food is to do the will of the one who sent me and to finish his work. Do you not say, in 4 months the harvest will be here? I tell you, look up and see the fields ripe for the harvest. The reaper is already receiving payment and gathering crops for eternal life, so that the sower and reaper can rejoice together. For here the saying is verified that one sows and another reaps. I send you to reap what you have not worked for. Others have done the work, and you are sharing the fruits of their work. Many of the Samaritans of that town began to believe in him because of the word of the woman who had testified. He told me everything I have done, she said. When the Samaritans came to him, they invited him to stay with them, and he stayed there 2 days. Many more began to believe in him because of his word, and they said to the woman, we no longer believe because of your word, for we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this is truly the Savior of the world. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Please be seated. My dear friends, the church has instructed us and has chosen to read this particular gospel for the first scrutiny, which we celebrate today, which is the day in which they receive the prayers of all of us, those who are preparing for baptism. So for the rest of us, even though these readings are recommended by the church to the whole, all of us, because all of us as a church, we journey together with them in prayer and in this spirit of repentance and the spirit of scrutinizing ourselves as we walk together to Easter to renew our baptism and to accompany you in your baptism. So these are the readings from cycle A. These are not the readings that you would probably hear in other masses, although you may, because even when there are no elect, the church also recommends to use these readings every year for these 3 Sundays of Lent. So, okay. So what do we see? Why do you think, let's try to unpack this. Why would the church ask us or invite us to use these particular readings in preparation for baptism and in preparation to renew our baptism and to receive the sacraments of candidates are? Why? They are so rich in the meaning of our journey for the divine life. And let us try to unpack this with just a couple of ideas. There's plenty of more, but I'd like to invite you to follow me on these couple of ideas. God is always looking for you. God is always looking for you, for us. It is not us who are looking for God. And we see this reflected beautifully in Jesus, who comes out to Samaria. Samaria was a forbidden region for the Jews because, as it says here in the gospel, they did not have anything in common. On the contrary, they were rivals. They were considered, the Samaritans were considered pagans. So, thinking a little bit of geography, you know, there's Galilee, there's Samaria, and then there is Jerusalem. So, for all the Galileans, as Jesus was a Galilean,
to go to Jerusalem, naturally they would have to go through Samaria. Well, they had two choices. Either cross to Syria and then go to Jerusalem, or go behind the mountains out of the region of Samaria to go to Jerusalem. But they would never go right across to get to Jerusalem. And the Jews would go to Jerusalem every year to the temple as part of their religious practices. So they would do that. Jesus chose not to do that. Jesus chooses to go straight through to Samaria. And that's what happens with us. God is always after us. God is always seeking for us, looking for us out of his love, because God is love, and the love of God does not permit him to do anything else but to look for you, to look for you, to look for you. Those of you who are journeying through the sacraments, you think, oh, good, my mom is making me do this. The adults think, well, maybe my fiancé. Or maybe, I don't know, just grandma or whatever, somebody is doing it. No, 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 no. It's God. It's God who is looking for you. And through your fiancé, through your mom, through whatever, grandma, whatever, whoever, God is choosing this person to call you to himself, to call you to his love. God is always looking for you. So, second idea, why is he looking for us? Just because he wants us, he wants to own us? Just because he wants us to obey him and to be subject to him? A lot of people think that way. Oh no, you know, I'm free. I don't obey, you know. God is okay, but you know, I follow my own rules, my own path, my own decisions. No, that's totally wrong. That is not biblical. God is looking for us, and I'll quote, God is looking for us to give you the living water that will well up to you in you for eternal life. To give you a spring of water welling up to eternal life. That's why he's looking for you. That's why he's looking for us. Because he wants to give us this eternal life out of love, out of passion for you. God is passionate about you. God is passionate about us. And it is reflected here. He wants to give us his life. His divine life that you will receive on your baptism. When you are baptized, you will be receiving this divine life that all of us who are already baptized already have. That's why God is looking for you. That's why God is looking for us, to give us his divine life. Nothing else. Not to give you to make you or me a slave. And no, to give us eternal life. So what is the divine life? How does he want to enter into this relationship with us? How does God want to enter into this relationship with us? And this is literally like mind-blowing. He wants to have a relationship with you. And you know what kind of relationship? For the youngsters, this may not make much sense, but I'll explain. He wants to have a spousal relationship, like a spouse, like a husband, like a wife, a marriage relationship with us. Why? Spouses, husbands, wives, spouses, they share their lives in such an intimate way. They share emotionally, physically, spiritually. They share everything. And when they have children, they even share more. So this is the kind of relationship that God is looking for you, with you and me, in this eternal life this relationship. How is this reflected here? Well, here goes a little story, but it's just so real. You look at the gospel, at the scripture, and every time there is a well mentioned, there's marriage. There is marriage coming up. Okay, why? Think of it. Back in the days, they didn't have social media. They didn't have Snapchat or dating apps or anything like that. And people were like really scattered. It was not like, you know, the zip code this and zip code there. It was people scattered. So the place to meet your possibly future husband or wife is at the well. At the well. That's where everybody met. Okay? So you know, you go to the well and it's where you would probably meet your future bride. The little personal story was kind of is funny just to kind of share with you. When I was a teenager, I was living in the city, but I would go regularly to the town, you know, where my family was brought up. My dad was born, and it's a small village, you know, up in Michoacán. And they would send me to get the water, to go to the plaza to get water, right? Because we had no running water. So there, me, the city boy, you know, playing around with the rest of the teenagers or youngsters there, I happened to just pull this girl from the rebozo, from the shop, okay? And just playing around, I don't know how I did it. I wasn't even conscious. Well, guess what? They wanted to marry her. They wanted me to marry her. I was at the well. She was at the well. And I pulled her shawl, so, oh, you gotta marry her. What? So I went right back to the city. But it's just so true. It's just so true that at the well. So where does Jesus meet the Samaritan woman? At the well. This tells us the kind of relationship Jesus wants to have with you. A spousal relationship. An intimate relationship. A relationship in which you share everything. Your mind. Your feelings, your emotions, your life, your existence. It's right there at the well. So this is the divine life that God wants for you. And how does this happen? Through the sacraments. Through the sacraments, through the sacraments, through the sacraments. This does not happen by hugging trees and, you know, feeling the energies and just this crazy stuff, no? Cleansing your aura. It doesn't happen that way. Divine life is not about that. Divine life, this spousal relationship that God wants to have with you and me, only happens through the sacraments. And that's precisely what you are going to receive, my friends. The sacraments, the divine life, the divine life. That's how it happens. And for the rest of us who are already baptized, and are journeying to Easter, we're journeying to renew our spousal relationship with God as we renew our baptism and as we renew this eternal life that God has given us through the sacraments. Now, third point. This eternal life, this spousal relationship, and those of you who are spouses, know this, is demanding. It's demanding. It's demanding. It takes effort. It doesn't just happen. I don't think you and I know any spouse that will be okay with just you know, having a spouse who, well, you know, show up whenever you want. You know, I'll be here. Are you okay with that kind of a spouse? I don't think so, right? But same thing with God. It takes responsibility. It's not like we show up whenever we want, whenever we feel like, whenever we have time. But you try to do that to your spouse, see how much it lasts. It doesn't. It takes responsibility. It takes effort. And how do we see this in this? It takes sacrifices. It takes conversion. It takes stripping yourself of your own privileges and wants and desires so that you can give yourself to the other. Divine life requires that. Remember, Jesus says, go call your husband. But I don't have any. You're right. You don't have any. You have five. And the one you're with is not your husband. So what is that? What is Jesus saying there? He's making the woman look at the life that she's living, at the lack of commitment with one or another husband. He's looking at, as he's making the woman look introspectively inside to scrutinize herself, to scrutinize her life and see how far apart she has been from walking the right path. He's calling her to responsibility. He's calling her to look at the things that she needs to let go in her life. Her pleasures. Her whatever. So that she can have this divine life. But the same thing for us. The divine life that God wants for us, it takes responsibility. It takes effort. It takes renouncing and letting go of our own needs, our own wants, our own desires, our own passions, our own thirsts, so that we can be filled only by the spousal love of God, of Jesus. So this is why the scrutinies happen today. This is why we also do the sacrament of confession regularly, so that we can look at our lives and see how am I responsibly responding to this spousal relationship with God and His church. This is why we scrutinize ourselves and ask, what are the things that I'm going to have to let go? What did the woman do? She was so thirsty. She went for water, to look for water, because she was thirsty, obviously. She needed that water. And you and I imagine, we don't know probably by experience, but you and I can imagine how important is water in the desert, right? And what did she do? The woman left her jar and went. She forgot. Why? Because she had the divine life that Jesus was offering her. So us too, when we choose to satisfy our thirsts with the divine life that Jesus gives us, we forget about all the other thirsts, all the other wells that we go to. The wells of addictions. The wells of negative attitudes, selfishness, resentment, hatred, whatever wells that we go to try to drink up, and then at the end we end up more thirsty than we were before. It takes responsibility. And lastly, one last idea. What does the woman do? Letting ourselves be found by Jesus, receiving this divine life that He has for us, and responsibly responding to this divine life, number four, we go out in mission to tell others where we have found the living water, We go out and tell others and witness to others where we have found this living water. And we tell them also, you know what? I was also thirsty like you are. I was also looking for pleasure, for power, for possessions. And I was never satisfied. But now I have found Jesus. I have found the living water, the divine life that Jesus has for us. So my dear friends, you and I can see how beautiful this encounter with Jesus is. And that is what's going to happen to you in your baptism. That is what's going to happen to you when you receive the body of Christ, when you receive the confirmation, marriage, and all of us, when we renew this Easter season, our divine life, as we renew our baptismal promises. Let us pray that we may worthily prepare for this Easter so that we may enjoy and receive this divine life. Amen. I now have the privilege to call the following elect to please stand up when I call your name. Jose Chavez, Miguel Alcala, Adrian Chavez, Abdias Hernandez, Patricia Nunes, Leslie Acedo, Melanie Gutierrez, Maria Lopez, Jose Edgardo Calix, Jerica Martinez, Natalie Ramirez, Jesus Javier Barragan, Christopher Reyes, Elizabeth Suzanne Wilson, Willie Kenneth Guevara, Demian Torres, Daniela Miranda, Kenneth Jimenez, Sean Ponce, Bryant Mejia, Wendy Santos, Kaylee Rosas Benitez, Nathan Torres, Adrian Torres, Andrew Torres, Stephen Piesky, Kaylee Marie Sarko, Valerie Delia Sarco, Adelie Ochoa, Uriel Reyes, Fernando Rodriguez. My dear friends, I address all of you in the assembly to please take a moment of silence, putting our hands together and pray for these catechumens, for these elect of God. Elect of God, putting your hands out as receiving the graces of the prayers of the community, join us in prayer also in silent prayer.
Deserts of poverty, apathy, greed, disrespect, and pollution of the environment. And so we cry,
harsh like the desert sand, Christ be our font of life, Kyrie eleison.
Thirsting for justice, acceptance, freedom from addiction, healing, and forgiveness. forgiveness, and so we cry,
harsh like the desert sand, Christ, we are font of life, Kyrie eleison.
Our society is patched dry by gangs, violence, physical and sexual abuse, racism, consumerism, and lack of respect for life. And so we cry,
harsh like the desert sand, Christ be our font of life, Kyrie eleison.
Our community wanders in the deserts of bigotry, gossip, gun violence, fear, alienation, and hopelessness. And so we cry,
harsh like the desert sand, Christ be our font of life, Kyrie eleison.
We are parched dry.
Continue with your hands out, please. God of power, you sent your only Son to be our Savior. Grant that these elect, who, like the woman of Samaria, thirst for living water, may turn to the Lord as they hear his word and acknowledge the sins and weaknesses that weigh them down. Protect them from vain reliance on self, and defend them from the power of Satan. Free them from the spirit of deceit, so that admitting the wrong they have done, they may attain purity of heart and advance on the way of salvation. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Now the elect are going to be anointed in the chest with this holy oil as we play some background music and we continue in prayer for them. padrinos se ponen de pie, le ponen la mano de su mano o los papás en el hombro a los niños, a los jóvenes, a los ahijados. Lord Jesus, you are the fountain for which they thirst. You are the master whom they seek. In your presence, they dare not claim to be without sin, for you alone are the Holy One of God. They open their hearts to you in faith. They confess their faults and lay bare their hidden wounds. In your love, free them from their infirmities, heal their sickness, quench their thirst, and give them peace. In the power of your name, which we call upon in faith, stand by them now and heal them. Rule over their spirit of evil. Conquered by your rising from the dead, show your elect the way of salvation in the Holy Spirit, that they may come to worship the Father in truth, for you live and reign forever and ever. You may be seated, please. We're now going to proceed with the consecration of the Eucharist. Normally, you will be dismissed to go continue studying the Word of God, but because of the pandemic, we cannot do that at this time. So you're staying with us, even though you cannot share in the body of Christ as well as the candidates, but you will join us spiritually in this spiritual communion. Continuamos con el ofertorio. Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Father Almighty. May your merciful grace prepare your servants, O Lord, for the worthy celebration of these mysteries and lead them by a devout way of life through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
With your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For when he asked the Samaritan woman for water to drink, he had already created the gift of faith within her, and so ardently did he thirst for her faith that he kindled in her the fire of divine love. So we too give you thanks, and with the angels praise your mighty deeds as we acclaim the hymn of your praise. Same Jesus that came out to Samaria to meet the woman at the well comes out to meet us at the Eucharist. That's why at this moment of the Mass we kneel acknowledging that Jesus becomes truly and really present in the sacrament of the Eucharist. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the font of all holiness. Make holy therefore these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant. It will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith.
Save us, Savior of the world, for by your cross and resurrection you have set us free.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly, we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity together with Francis, our Pope, Jose Gomez, our Archbishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Assist your servants, the elect, with your grace, O Lord, we pray, that they may lead these chosen ones by word and example to new life in Christ our Lord. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Let us please stand and pray together with confidence to the Father as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant us peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, the glory are yours
now. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant us peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with all of you. With our right hand over our heart, let us wish each other a sign of peace. Peace of Christ. Peace of Christ. Peace of Christ. Behold the Lamb of God, behold Jesus, who comes out to meet us as he met the woman at the well to give us his divine life. Blessed are those invited to the banquet of the Lord. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. For the sponsors who are visiting us, are accompanying us from different communities, you are going to be guided when to come forward to receive the body of Christ. Please, through the same aisle that you come up, the same aisle you go back to your place. Para los padrinos y padrinas que nos están acompañando de otras comunidades, para acompañar a sus ahijados, los servidores les van a indicar en qué momento pasan para recibir el cuerpo de Cristo. Y por el mismo lugar por el que pasan al frente, por ese mismo pasillo, regresan, por favor, a sus lugares. No se atraviesen entre las sillas o entre la gente, por favor. Tomen asiento, por favor. Let us pray. Give help, O Lord, we pray, by the grace of your redemption, and be pleased to protect and prepare those you are to initiate through the sacraments of eternal life through Christ our Lord. Please be seated for a moment. We're going to have our customary second collection. En este momento se toma la segunda colecta, que es para las obras de caridad. Second collection, remember, is that for the works of charity that we have as a parish. Avisos. Para salir del estacionamiento, van a salir solamente hacia la calle Pine, no, que sí, la Pine, ¿verdad? Solamente, por favor, al tráfico hacia allá, hacia la Pine, a la Pine, porque por la Clarkson va a estar entrando la gente para la siguiente misa, que también pues ya estamos un poquito apretados de tiempo. Entonces, por favor, solo para la calle Pine para salir. So, to exit the parking lot, please only use the exit towards the Pine Street. do not go that way, go always that way, so that because people entering to the next mass are lining up and coming in through the Clarkson entrance. So please only use that exit. Also, for all the catechumens, the next two Sundays are going to be a repeat, but not really. But as far as the logistics, it's a repeat of today. So now we have a better notion of where we're supposed to be sitting. So all the catechumens or elect are going to be sitting on this section, and everybody else, we're going to be sitting on this section. Their families can sit back there, and they, you know, we adapt to the restrictions of. That we have, so we do the best that we can. So it's essentially that, but of course the prayers, the intentions, and everything else is different. The content is different, but as far as the logistics, it's pretty much the same. Los próximos dos domingos son como ahora, en cuanto a la logística, es lo mismo, se sientan todos de este lado, los que son elegidos, con un padrino. Si tienen los padrinos, pueden irse turnando los padrinos para estar con ellos. Y la familia y todos los acompañantes en el resto del espacio. Los candidatos para comunión y confirmación también, ¿verdad?, en esta área se sientan aquí. Acá solamente los que van a ser bautizados. Y es importante no fallar ningún escrutinio. Sepamos que el rito, o sea, ya empezó, sus sacramentos ya empezaron. Ya empezó, esto es el principio. Si no vienen a un escrutinio, es como si llegan al bautizo, pero se salen y luego regresan al rato, pues no, pues es un solo momento, ¿no? Entonces, por favor, no falten ningún escrutinio, a menos que Dios no lo quiera, que estén enfermos o con COVID o algo así, pero primeramente Dios, van a estar bien con la fuerza de las oraciones de toda la comunidad que seguimos orando también por ustedes. Solamente el obispo puede dispensar de un escrutinio, entonces, si alguien no viene a uno de los siguientes domingos, tiene que escribirle al obispo para ver si los dispensa de que no vinieron. Y eso va a estar muy, muy difícil. Entonces, por favor, no falten a ninguno de los escrutinios. Please do not miss any of the scrutinies. Only the bishop can dispense of the scrutinies, not I. So if somebody does not show up for one of the scrutinies, have to write to the bishop asking for a dispensation, and that's not likely to happen. So please, you have journeyed all this far, and this is a time like Jesus tells us, you know, to sacrifice and be here early, please. Okay, thank you so much. Everyone else, we continue praying for the elect and also for the rest of the candidates for the sacraments. That's it. We'll leave it at that. Let us please stand. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Our Mass is ended. We may go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Please try to avoid gathering on the area there because there's going to be traffic. Just go straight to your cars and see you next week. God bless you.
Rise in me, arise, and dispel all the darkness. Rise in me, arise.